Yeah, hi. My name is Mike Rocker, and I'm going to talk about the Invisible Closer now. First of all, quickly about me. I work on the Linux kernel, the Invisible Closer, open and beta stuff. I'm a maintainer in these projects, one way or the other. I do a PJ work as a hobby as well. So that's about me. I decided to split the talk into a couple of sections. So first of all, I'd like to introduce you to what the bootloader is at all, what the Invisible bootloader is, what it can do. Then I'll have a brief newsflash for those people who already did some Invisible work so that they know what happened in the latest releases, so I can sync them up. And this will be really brief. After that, I'll go into the Invisible porting. I'll tell you how to get the sources, how to compile them, how to configure the stuff, how to add new stuff into the Invisible. I'll talk about the driver model, which is a recent development. I'll talk about the device tree control. And once we build up all that knowledge, doing the Ubuntu port for the architecture port is going to be really trivial because you will have the understanding of the stack. So we'll do that in the second half of the talk. And since enabling all that stuff will make Ubuntu grow in size considerably, we'll talk about low memory systems. And then we'll wrap it up and move on to the next one. So, what is a bootloader in the first place? Well, you see, when you power up your computer or system or whatever, there has to be some code which does some basic initialization of the system and make it possible to load the next stage and execute the next thing. And that's the bootloader's task. Now, in modern systems, it just so happens that there are multiple bootloaders which are kind of chain loading one another. You know, think of any modern SoC has this boot drum on it, and when you flick on the power, it just jumps into the boot drum. The boot drum is executed, does some initialization, then loads some stuff from whatever SD card, and executes that stuff in the OC RAM. The stuff in the OC RAM usually initializes DRAM, loads more stuff from maybe SD card, maybe some other storage into the DRAM, and that's typically the first bootloader which you can replace. And that's responsible for starting the Linux kernel. So this kind of chain loading happens nowadays. It's the same on Intel where you have like this behind us which kind of starts your graph and that starts the kernel, that kind of thing. So that's what bootloader does. Ubuntu is one of these bootloaders. There are alternatives, but Ubuntu is like the omnipresent bootloader on most of the ARMnet boards. I said, yeah, it's capable of loading Linux, starting Linux, that's true, but it can also do much more. It can behave as a good monitor, debug tool. So, basically, can drop into the Ubuntu shell, poke registers, and do a lot of other stuff. To give you an idea how the board looks when you start Ubuntu, this is what you get. This is usually the first print on the board, which you get. What you see here is the Ubuntu version, CPU type, board model. In case you're reporting some bugs in Ubuntu, please include at least these information on which Ubuntu sources did you use to compile that stuff, because sometimes it's just some vendor hacked up crap and we cannot help you with that. If you get mainline Ubuntu, well, we'll kind of figure it out and we probably can help you with it. So what we have in that print is some information about the hardware which is available, how much DRAM you have. On this board you have some TMMC controllers, serial board controllers here, Ethernet, whatever. Ultimately you reach the out-of-boot countdown. Now if you let it count down to zero, you would go execute this out-of-boot command, which usually means start Linux. It can be anything, but in the most cases it's just like load Linux from somewhere, start it, and that's where you would end. Now you can interrupt that out-of-boot countdown and then you will drop into the Ubuntu shell where you can do a lot of stuff. Like for example, execute the help command, which is really helpful. That also tells you what that Ubuntu port supports. Usually you can, in this case I'm reading memory, you can do a lot of other stuff. Drive memory, you can poke the registers, you can access different bus systems like I2C, SPI. You can access storage, EMMC, again, SPI flashes, MP devices, UMP storage. You can access Ethernet. You can do UMP download files and so on. That's what you can do with the Ubuntu. If you export the help or the remix, you will see what else you can do. Now, This is a brief news flash about both you and Newman in 2018 and what happened in the last year pretty much. So we're continuing conversion to device-free control and driver model. At this point, we only have like legacy drivers which are not yet converted. And most of that is probably going to be away, going away, because no one really cares about that anymore. So we'll just nip it out from the code base. In case you still have some legacy devices and want it out, that's just welcome. We also got EFI support in U-Boot, and what that's for is U-Boot can now behave like an EFI library and execute EFI applications. So this is, for example, useful if you want to chain load drop from U-Boot and make it look like kind of like the drop you're used to on PC. At that point, you can execute the drop EFI application, and the drop EFI application is calling into the U-Boot, which is providing the services like serial port access, storage access. So, that sort of thing. In case you're building some sort of dev board, you should probably enable that. Related to that is the sort of boot command support. Again, if you're building a dev board, you should enable that. It allows you to set up some sort of standardized U-Boot environment which the distribution can count on, and then it's easy for the distribution to generate boot images and boot them on your dev board. So they can look into that. Oh yeah, we are also doing CI recently, which is cool. So if you used to submit patches to U-Boot and you were asked to build it for like these 10 architectures, it kind of sucked because you had to get all these cross compilers and it was kind of mad. Nowadays you can just push it to GitHub and there's a Travis CI, Travis YAML file, YAML? Something like that, YAML file which will trigger the Travis automatically, it will do the CI run if you enable that. And you can just collect the results on the patch and know that they will release for all the architectures. One last thing we did recently is device-free overlay application. Now, what that is about is since this sort of situation was configured as device-free overlay holder in Linux, not finding its way in mainline like ever, probably, it was pushed down into the bootloader so that NewBoot is now capable of applying device-free overlay to the device chain and passing this patch device-free to Linux. And recently, we also support for that fit image. So you can have a fit image with Linux kernel, device-free fragments, and in the fit image configuration, you can specify which kernel you want to use, which device-free and which fragments should be applied on that. And you will assemble that into the Linux kernel. Now, if you have no idea what that means, it doesn't matter really. This is just really advanced stuff. Yeah. Oh, yeah. By the way, about this device-free overlay, there might be a change in the overlay format, so be careful about using that stuff. Okay. Now let's get to forcing U-Boot. So first of all, obviously, you need to get the sources if you want to do any U-Boot porting or any U-Boot work. You can get them at SteamRepo. It's accessible through Git and HTTP. So if you have like some sort of crappy corporate firewall which doesn't let you make sure that you need HTTP. Usually you should use the Git master repo because everything is there. But if you're working with one of the maintainers and he says, yeah, well, in my subtree there's some feature and you need that feature to get it in the subtree, it's available right here. And once you have the sources, you probably want to build them, right? So it's really trivial. I would just clone them, change the directory into the source tree. If you're cross compiling, you need to export this to variables, cross compile the prefix and the architecture name for which you're cross compiling. It is not necessary to do that if you're compiling natively or if you are the sample target. If you're not doing that, you will also need the cross compiler, cross the details, and that sort of stuff. Now, once you have all that set up, you can do make board underscore bat config. Obviously, you need to have that board supported. This will configure the U-Boot sources, and then you can update it according to the U-Boot binary, which you can then put on the board. The board has to be supported. You can check if the board is supported by looking into the config directory in the U-Boot source tree. If your board is not supported, well, patches are welcome. I think we support like 500 boards, maybe more. I would have to check them. So I mentioned the sandbox target. This is kind of interesting because you can compile the UGUID as a Linux application and you can launch it in your Linux system and then play around with the UGUID shell, and you can also use it for some tests in case you're doing some work on the UGUID shell. From there, you don't need to put some files, you just run a sandbox test config, make, and it will just release UGUID, which is under ELF binary, so you can just .slash UGUID and you will get the shell and you can play around. That's what I mean. Alright, but if you want to do some work on the UGUID besides compiling it, you probably should know where everything fits. So the hierarchy of the UGUID source tree from this, you know, the Arch directory, that's where all the architecture specific stuff, the common stuff goes. So you have like Arch, NMN, for example, Arch ARM, Arch MIPS, whatever. That's where the common stuff for that architecture goes. You will also have directory mock-foo, where foo is like code specific to the SOC in that architecture. You can think of that like the mock of FPGA for Altera of FPGA, which is an ARM core in there, and ARM SOC, or mock PCM for the chips which are in Raspberry Pi. You also have device resources there in the same place. And this are sources for the UGUID control device tree. This is not passed to the Linux. So the device trees which are passed to the Linux are separate from that. What else do we have here? Board files are the board. Usually when you do a new UGUID port, there shouldn't be that much stuff which you need to add into the board. All that should be in drivers or in the device tree. We have the config I mentioned earlier. This is the main config for the UGUID. We also are still in the process of converting the legacy config macro to the game config, so you will find some legacy configs that include config slash your board delay, unfortunately. But yeah, this is work in progress, reflecting that. Then you can have some drivers, even commands and implementations, network stack, file systems, and so much more in here. Now, if you look into the UGUID sources, you will see that there are a config, config files and main files all across the UGUID hierarchy. Implies we use kconfig for configuration of UGUID, just like the kernel we use kago for building UGUID nowadays. So you can do the usual stuff like make menu config just like you are using the kernel, you will get a nice same versus menu that will be available there. I mentioned briefly for converting to that, so there are some symbols which are not converted. So in case you're looking for them in this make menu config, you don't find them. It could be that they are still not converted, and then you change this widest file if they are in there. And then they will have to go into include slash config slash your board dot page. Or you can convert them to kconfig send us a patch, which will be amazing. Thank you. Now, all new options, in case you decide to add any new kconfig option, it has to be kconfig only. There's no way in hell you are adding non-kconfig option. It just won't. It will fly, not that many. And you can have an idea of what the kconfig stuff looks like. I picked this driver SMET kconfig file, right? So what you see here is the symbol config vmdh. So if you like to make menu config, you'll be able to find that there is vmdh symbol somewhere in the intrusive menu. So what do we have here? The symbol is Boolean, so if you need to make menu config, you will find some entry which looks like this. You can turn it on and off with Boolean. It depends on another symbol, which is the M, and then there's some help associated with that. Now there's a little quirk in that if you enable the DMETH, it will actually show up as config underscore DMETH in your .config file. And that's then picked by the table system to operate in these symbols, so in makefiles. So, when the main file actually gets evaluated, this will attempt to object dash Y in case config that Altera PSE is enabled in the kconfig. Alright, that's pretty much it.
Now,
if you want to add any new stuff into the kconfig table files, just add the matching kconfig, add similar NPS as you saw on the previous slide. You have some sources associated with that, patch the main file, add the sources, and that's it, it's that simple. Now, One thing which I would like to ask you is not to add hardware specific stuff on platforms which are MIDI capable. So if you have a platform which is MIDI capable, you should add hardware specific or hardware topology specific stuff into the device tree instead of hard coding it into the user or into the KCON system. So speaking of device tree, what is a device tree? Well, how many of you actually do know what a device tree is? Very good. Super. Nice. So, yeah, the device tree is a structure which is used to describe hardware topology. It's not the case always that you can probe the hardware topology. You can think of like an SDI controller with just some devices hooked on it, and you just can't figure out what's on the other side of the box. That's why device tree. And we use that to describe the entire topology of the system. You can pass it to you, you can pass it to Linux, it doesn't matter. It's actually standardized, the device tree. You can find the standard in the e-paper documentation and further details on the device tree website. Now, it can have multiple representations. One of them is the device tree blob, the other is texture representation. There is also a YAML representation of the device tree, but I don't know what the state of that is. And instead of going into like specific details on how the device tree looks like, I'll just give you an example. So this is the device tree pulled from U-boot actually, but it's the same in U-boot. So U-boot and Linux are sharing the same device tree file. There are a couple of specific quirks to U-boot which we try to kind of keep separate, but the device tree files should be mostly the same. So what you see here in the device tree at the beginning, there's an input directive. This is just because both Linux and U-boot are running the device tree through C preferences to expand these macros here so that you don't have to encode numbers into the device tree by hand, so you can just use these symbols. And besides that, what do we have here? We have a root node marker in here, and then we get some device tree properties, which are these key value pairs in here, and then we have multiple other nodes under the root node. As you can see, there can be each node can have more nodes underneath that and properties and so on. And this way, you can describe the entire tree topology of the system. But the thing is, it might just so happen that you need to reference another node from a node in the device tree, and that kind of turns it into a tree to a graph. Like, you can see here, this is called the handle. So, this with that PMU is referencing the A57 core here. So, it's just not really creates a tree-like structure. But using this, you can describe the entire hardware to the software. Now, you use it in a few ways. One of them is it can load both Linux and the device tree and then start Linux and just pass the device tree to the Linux or other software, other kernel. And this is not really interesting, but what U does there is just it can patch a couple of things into the device tree before it passes it to the kernel. Usually that's an Ethernet address. So U would have this ETH header, MAC address, arrival, and if you are passing device tree to Linux, it can patch that arrival into the device tree block. And then start Linux, so you can share the same MAC address between you and Linux. But we are more interested in this device tree control thing. And what that is for is you can start U-boot and have it reference the device tree and read out the hardware topology out of the device tree super early on, and that way you don't have to encode any hardware specifics into the U-boot binary. Now, to understand at what point you is able to read out the stuff from the device tree, we should go through the process. So what happens when you actually enter the U-boot binary and then move on to the init until you reach the U-boot shell? That's what this slide is about. So when you put power in this, you see it goes through the bootroom or whatever first stage is until it reaches U-boot, at which point you land in the platform specific init code. Now this is all assembly, and basically you land at the reset vector where the U-boot is sitting. The platform specific code resides in R slash any whatever, and it's responsible for doing the platform specific setup. Now once said is building good GOM on the C runtime and set up code, which is up the C runtime, and after this is done, it can jump into the C code. The first C code that's run is the support app, and there's a list of functions which are running with the assumption that the system has very little RAM available, if at all, and can have to stack set up. When you go to this, these functions are actually responsible for setting up the RAM on some platform. So you need to allocate at the end of the RAM once you finish these functions. And that's the functions which are running with the assumption that you're already running in RAM and the memory constraints are not so bad. And once you finish the board R, you will enter the new shell, at which point the output prompt starts, and then you can interrupt it and enter the new shell. The request tree is actually available ever since the first function in the board F list, so it's available way early in the usable process once you leave the assembly. This is operating on the actual flattened device tree, so unflattening does not happen, it can't happen because you don't have any memory for that. Nowadays you do, but on the old platforms you just didn't. There's a nice trick to at least in a glitch, actually, in case you happen to have a problem in there and you kind of hang it somewhere in there in the interface, you can hack up this limit folder. See, there are two debug statements in there, you just replace that with printf, and you can go print each init function in this calling, including its base address. And then you can find out which was the last function which was actually called. And run object dump to use binary, figure out what's the actual name of the function, and then look into the code and see what actually happened and why it's affected by the web. So this is kind of neat, pretty obvious on the image groups. If you don't have a debugger attached to the system. Right, so now that you have the actually set up, if you look into the resources, you will see that there's like a gazillion of functions which are used to access the DB and it's totally inconsistent. So this slide tries to make it more understandable. So you'll see that there are functions which use the FDD prefix. These are coming from the libFDD and they have like a boatload of boilerplate code all over it. You ideally shouldn't use them unless you need to do something really obscure with the device stream. You'll have to code around all boilerplate. So we just kind of simplify that. That's why we have the FDDAG functions, and they basically just pull out all the boilerplate from the FDD functions, so you can just immediately access the device tree nodes and pull out strings, values, and so on out of them easily. But you should only use that outside of the unit driver model. Now, if you're within the unit driver model, there are other functions which take the unit device pointer. These are the read functions, and they allow you to pull out values from the device from the device tree node associated with that particular driver, like its base address, its clock mapping, and so on. So outside of the device tree, outside of the driver model, you see the within driver model. Right, that's pretty much it. Now, the next thing is the Ubuntu driver model. Okay, I don't have a good definition for what that is actually. So I'll tell you why it came to be. You see, back in the days of old, that means like 5 years, 6 years ago, the hardware started getting more complex, and the Ubuntu was still at that point configured with macros. All drivers were basically just talking directly to the commands, so if you wanted to have two H4C buses with different drivers, you were just screwed. And people started like coding around that through some obscure hacks, and that didn't scale, so we were like throwing this massive code base of hacks, it just couldn't go on. So we designed the driver model at that point, and ever since then we're converting to that. To remove all the tags and allow people to use different drivers with multiple instances and so on. Now, the driver model is kind of similar to Linux, but not so much because we have some space constraints and so on. We want to keep it kind of small and simple. There are actually three objects within the driver model. One of them is U class. Now, that one's responsible, well, that one's the API provider for the rest of the U-boot for a specific process hardware. Think of it like a serial leaf class is providing you, as a U-boot consumer, stuff like put C, get C, test C, that sort of thing. It is also tracking all the driver instances, matching that specific use class, which can provide these services. That means all the serial port drivers for the new bus serial. Now, you as a user can select which serial driver that new bus should call. Next thing is our drivers. Right, so these are the actual implementation of the register poking, which will get that service implemented. That means for a serial driver, it actually implements the PUTC for a specific kind of hardware. And finally, there are driver instances or devices. Now, these are instances of the drivers. You allocate some sort of structure with some data associated with that and registered with the class. So this also allows you to have two instances of a specific driver. That's not a problem. Register with the same class, just using different driving data. Now, the driving model core is actually designed to be rather lazy. So all it does during the initialization is it just registers the root driver. In case you have device tree control enabled, it just walks the device tree and binds all the drivers into this tree hierarchy. That's pretty much it. It does not initialize any of the drivers. It doesn't initialize any of the hardware unless you explicitly call through a U class and access that hardware. Now this is to make sure that you do not initialize more than you really need to actually get to the next stage. Like, for example, you do not need to initialize PCI Express if you're booting from SPI Flash, and the kernel is also stored in the SPI Flash. So that's the intention here. Now, we have a convenient command in U-boot, which is called DM3, and that will show you all the drivers which are bound into the tree and also those which are broke. So in this case, on this system, you can see when the system has started, we broke serial console, because we need that. I mean, this is printed on serial console, so we need the serial console to be made operational and broke. The serial port actually needs log and pin control to be configured, and that's why the pin control driver is broke, and the response driver somewhere here as well in that list. And obviously everything up from there is also broke because that has to be available for these devices to work. Yeah. There are multiple states in which the driver can be. One of them is bound, that means it's available to you. You would actually see that device as available, and on the first call, the driver will actually get probed. That means the hardware will get initialized, and all its dependencies will get initialized. In case you're implementing a U-boot driver, you usually don't have to implement the bind and the remove, bind and unbind functions because they will be replaced by the generic ones. Only in case you're doing something super specific, you might have to do something funny in the bind, but usually you don't need it. If you're implementing a U-boot driver, you should implement probe, obviously, because you need to start up the hardware somehow, you need to poke some registers and so on. And often you also need to peer it out. So the remove function will be called when you exit U-boot, for example, to start it. Now, it can just so happen that you will have some funny hardware in case you do not deinitialize it before stopping the kernel. It will do something obscure when the kernel tries to reinitialize the hardware. We had a situation where a USB controller did that. When Linux tried to reinitialize it, it will stop it in U-boot. The controller just vomited some rogue transmission into memory and just corrupted memory. It's really difficult to debug that, so you should implement the remove function. Right? Now, that should probably explain all the basic concepts in U-boot, I hope. And with that, we can go into the board porting. So what I'll be doing here is do a really simple board port. And you should do that. If you're doing board porting, you should really start simple. Just get the serial port running in the beginning and you know, add any fancy other stuff, because this will just introduce more variety to your board port, and you will not be able to make heads or tails of any failures. It will be just completely random. you can add all the functionality later when you have like a stable serial support and when you can get a fork around and you know that the board is stable. So that's not a problem. But in the beginning, we just started with this simple stuff. So what do we have here? Yeah. If you want that architecture, you need to want the R2 mapbar, which will be the name of your architecture. You can also support device tree in case your architecture is capable of that, and you can add more support. You want at least one board port because otherwise it will not be possible to use the Linux integration to make sure that your code does not start page dropping. If you want to add one port, you need to add styling the board / your manufacturer vendor name / your board name, and then you will have to add a config file, main file, your board, and the C file, which is like board specific stuff. You know, there shouldn't be that much stuff in the board specific file. Ideally, that should all be in the device tree or in the driver. You will also have to add your board config in the config, so micro test config, and you will also need to create a legacy configuration file because, well, some simple stuff will not convert it to things. Ideally, there shouldn't be that much stuff in this file, and that would be increasing access to the board. You will need to add a link to your board config file to our arm foo mapbar config entry to make sure that the config actually reads that port file. Alright. Sometimes you might have to tweak them. In the process of reboot, there are actually board specific groups for the init process. They do need to read the files for specific groups. Ideally, you don't need that, but if you do need that, well, that's where we are. Yeah, and those groups should just go into drivers and blockers. Now, how to implement the UBIT driver is actually not that difficult. All you need to do is define this sort of structure. We have this UBIT driver macro here. You specify the name of the structure from this driver, and that actually gets put into a specific UBIT linker list so that the UBIT driver model can iterate over all drivers. And when you, for example, device tree probing, access all the compatible strings and so on. Then you have to specify name, the name of the driver, and the ID, which is the U class into which the driver fits. This is a serial port driver which I borrowed, so this is a U class serial. You need to specify ops. The ops have to match the name of the U class, so for serial U class, you will have some game serial ops. I'll show that to you in the next slide. Now, what else do we have here? Yeah, if you're matching with device tree compatibles, you have to define how it match. Pro function, obviously, because you need to initialize the hardware. Primary data are actually allocated by driver model 4, so you don't have to call model kingdom driver. You just specify the size of your private data here. In case you want to make sure that you can scope the driver from both device tree and board file using platform data, which may be convenient if you need to reduce size, implement these two functions. This function which converts the device tree content to platform data and then specify the size of the platform data which can be allocated. Again, the driver model 4 will do the allocation for you. Since this is a serial port driver, there's a special flag which says the serial port driver should be available super early at the beginning of the process. You may just need serial port output early on to get that some bugs then in view and then they want to space some warning or something like that. Usually even flag in your drivers. Now, matching the device tree compatibles, that looks like this. You just provide the OF match table that's very similar to Linux. You can have metadata associated with that, so that when you mention some compatible, then the code can tell what compatible you actually matched onto. You can even pass pointers for this, so you can kind of have a cluster associated with that. That's no problem. The function which is converting the device tree into the platform data looks like this. In this example, I just grab the platform data pointer, which is allocated by the DM4. I extract some information from the device tree in this case as a base address. If it's valid, then I just set it into the platform data base address. function, and the probe function can reference the plant database and just be sure that this is set with polished content. And finally, the implementation of the ops, since this is a serial E class, you will be using the serial ops, which implement the FTC, XC, character in the serial for FIFO and sense object generator. The function is then implemented like so, the exposure coming in, you can get the primary, and there should be registered broken here, but it's implemented in the serial get generator itself. It's actually a little inside, but the serial for get, the SH serial get the generator will implement actual register broken, giving the preference. So, that's pretty much it for a serial point driver. Now, it may just so happen that you will want to have some even earlier debug serial console. You can enable that with the debug viewer, and it's really like this special stuff which doesn't even fit into the driver model properly, but it might come helpful. It uses its specific sets of print commands. It doesn't even use the printf, the standard printf index, and that sort of stuff. You have to implement this piece of code into your serial driver, which really initializes everything on the serial driver by hooking the registers directly. It doesn't bind on the device screen at all. And you have to implement the sort of C, which makes sure to emit the serial port, the character on the serial port. And so this is like super specific. It's probably convenient if you have like a debug viewer dedicated one on that platform. Otherwise, you will most likely not need that. The other thing is, if you implemented your serial code driver now with Perlini's clock, well, implementing a clock driver is exactly the same thing. It's just the class clock, and it has DM CLK ops, which allow you to like enable, disable clock, get and set rate, that sort of thing. So this is boring, I really won't get into it, and I will show you how the consumer works. So the user of the clock framework will use CLK underscore function, so like CLK get rate, set rate, and so on. Serial port driver, for example, can tap into it itself. So let's see. Yeah, first of all, we're continuing to get the clock handle. This is pulled from the clock device tree property associated with the device. So you'll have in the device tree. Node for this serial port clock property and clock names property. The clock property will contain the handle to the clock controller and possibly an ID of the clock. And the clock names property will contain this SDK string. So we'll be able to the clock framework will do that for you. It will look up which clock controller that is. And we'll fill up this structure accordingly. If that works out, then you will be able to use this structure to access those clocks and enable them. So what the enable will do is it will actually internally go to the new class CLK, find the matching clock controller, and call the driver model CLK in option with the specific clock ID in the clock driver, and the clock driver will then enable the clock. And if that works out, we can get to the clock the driver.
So another thing is the pink control framework. Again, implementing pink control drivers, the same thing as pink force for the clock driver, serial drivers, just the same, easy. There's just a small quirk in the pink control framework in that yeah, it implements two things. One of them is pinbooks, the other is pincorp, and this can be kind of confusing. So pinbooks is a thing which allows you to select which logical block in the CPU connects to a specific pin on the CPU, and pincorp allows you to select the properties of that specific pin, that means like voltage, pull up, pull down, that sort of properties. This framework implements both of them, actually. You have to enable something like config DM. Pink one, I believe, to have the extra functionality out of it. It's, again, the end of single control off. Consuming this API is a little different because, in this case, case, you do not poke specific pins in the driver, then fluid test won't work because different pin control controls can look differently. Is that in device tree you specify multiple pin control configurations, multiple ways to configure the pins with different properties and associated pin control names, and then in case the driver wants to set one of the other configurations of the pin, you just call pin control that solid state and solid matching state. So in this case, either UHS or default, so it's matching with this one. This specific case is an EMMC controller which is operating EMMC in either 3.3 volt setting or 1.8 volt UHS setting. So we have a message in the driver, and why we have two different types of pin control there. Now, there are other frameworks and so on in EMMC, but most of them are converted to driver models, so it will look exactly the same. There are a couple which are kind of still iffy and mostly on the legacy stuff, so like Pyron or the MPD framework is kind of iffy there, but the rest is pretty much okay. But enabling all that stuff may trigger some problems with size. So I would like to talk about low memory systems now. It could also be that even if you do not enable the device tree control driver model, you will run into some size limits. So this is kind of our problem. If you think of a modern ARM SoC nowadays, it's usually what it does when it starts up is it loads a small piece of code into the OCRAM that's supposed to initialize the DRAM and load the next thing, right, into the DRAM and execute it there. So we support that with EBoot. It's called EBoot SDL. It's really just a top-down version of EBoot which fits into tens of kilobytes. You can have the SoC load that desktop which configures the DRAM, starts the DRAM, and then loads the next thing. Now the SDL is capable of loading either the full EBoot or it can load Linux directly to reduce your boot time. It's called the Falcon mode. You can take a look at that. The SDL doesn't have to have device tree control at all. It also doesn't have to have driver model. This is optional, but it can be enabled. Now you can configure both the EBoot and the EBoot SDL separately in your pconfig file. You can config SDL prefix for SDL and config underscore prefix for full EBoot. In case this is still not enough, your system has some limitations where the EBoot SDL will not fit either. You can have the DTL, which is like generally your program loader, and this is usually consistent with one man flashes where the window from which the system is booting is like 4 kilos or 2 kilos, and this is like super specific for just starting it up, copying the rest of the content of the one-man flash into the CPU, so CRAM, which will then be viewed with SPL, and then it will be used with the SPL. Avoid the DPL, that would be perfect because this is like super weak. And again, yeah, you can configure the DPL with something on this for DPL. You can have all three and configure them separately. That's not a problem. Now, the other thing is, if you're using device tree in EBoot SDL, it can trigger, again, some size limits. So what we do at this point is we compact the device tree block. If you add these EBoot DMC reload properties to the device tree nodes, you will not remove those nodes when you compact the device tree for the SDL. Otherwise, it will rip out all the nodes which didn't have this property to reduce the size of the block. Having the device support in SDL is still too much for you. You can remove it completely and just throw a platform data from your board file in the SDL. And the lookup ID is quite happy, so this will save you some size in the SDL. And yeah, that's pretty much it for me. I would like to kind of summarize it. So if you're doing new report, UTM, UTD, use kconfig symbols, pretty much what I would like you to do if you're doing report. If drivers are existing, don't write new ones. Just reuse whatever is available as new DD compatible. For example, on some systems, we use a TCAR controller drivers, which are written from completely different systems. because that device is compatible with Fine before it's not a problem. If you have some fixes, whatever, submit patches, it may just happen that it will not go in on the first try, but keep going, run them through the CI before submitting, run them to check that. And, well, if you need some help, change the documentation in the dog directory. If that's not enough, train up an IRC, just ask questions, wait for a couple of hours, because there may not be anyone in the IRC who's actually know the answer to the question, so wait a couple of hours. Usually someone will figure that out. And if the IRC is in sufficient, submit questions to the ML, submit values to the mailing list. That's pretty much it. So thank you for your attention and questions.
Yeah, there's always different.
There are some drivers which are just written from scratch. That's true.